thank our dignitaries this morning. I want to actually thank, and if you'll save all the applause for the very last piece, I'm just going to announce all of our people that are actually here. If I miss anyone, I do apologize for that. I have to start by saying thank you to our students for being responsible and being exactly where they were supposed to be this morning. I want to say thank you to our mentors. They have been absolutely wonderful. We probably had about 4 or 5 meetings to kind of get this planned, and it was really focused on our students, and our students really kind of drove that particular planning, so we're really excited about that. We want to actually thank Congressman James Moran for being here this morning, Dr. Sherman, our superintendent for Alexandria City Public Schools, Ms. Maxey, our principal of T.C. Williams High School. We also want to thank Ms. Laverne Chapman, Jackson Chapman, President and CEO of the National Urban League of Northern Virginia. We want to also thank Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley from Alpha Street Baptist Church. We want to thank our Reverend Dr. Lee Earl from Shiloh Baptist Church. Also, Mr. John Rosenthal, which is one of our mentors, Mr. Bill Porter, which is one of our mentors. And we want to also say thank you to our 6 students that are going to actually be presenting, and you're going to meet them a little later. We could just give everyone on the program an applause. Thank you. We're going to move right along with our program at this time. We're going to actually have our very own Congressman James Moran to come up and speak about the importance of mentoring.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Cook. Well, we're moving this right along. That's a good thing. We've got a lot of things we need to do today. But this is a terrific way to start off the day. And obviously, we want to thank our superintendent for hosting it within the Alexandria school system. We do want to recognize our Alexandria City Councilman, Rob Kropika, is here. Our school board members, Helen Morris and Blanche Maness and Cheryl Gorsuch, are here as well. I want to recognize Zachary Kafritz, who does education for me. Some folks may not know Zachary. Why don't you stand up, Zachary? He's going to be our point man in our office. Zachary has a great background. He always gets, I'm sure he gets angry at me. He wouldn't tell me that, though, but he gets embarrassed. But his mother, Peggy Cooper Kafritz, was the chair of the D.C. school board for many years. His father has been very active in the Washington area, and Zachary is one of the most brilliant minds I've found. So we're putting him in charge of this program. So it tells you what the priority that we place on this. I want to thank Patty Moran too. She apparently this is neon day. Did you notice it? It's hard not to notice her. Embarrassing. I don't know why I'm saying this, but neon day. Where's Pat? There she is. Oh, smokes, geez. She apologized for not letting me know that it was neon day so I could wear some neon. I think that was just as well I didn't know because I wouldn't have worn it. But I'm glad she's wearing it. Anyways, let me not digress into all that. Ms. Maxey, we want to thank you for your work as principal of T.C. Williams. Of course, Laverne Chapman is, she's a force of nature. Running the Northern Virginia Urban League, unbelievable. And she and John Rosenthal, I really want to thank for realizing how important this was. And then, of course, our leaders within the faith community, our 2 principal leaders, Reverend Wesley of Alfred Street Baptist Church, which is a phenomenally fast-growing and influential community, as well as Reverend Lee Earl of Shiloh. These 2 guys could have run a whole city or a whole, they could have built New York City or whatever, but we've got them here in Alexandria. They can do anything they want to do because they're just so capable. You're going to hear, are you on this agenda, Reverend Wesley? Oh, you are? Okay, I didn't see you on the agenda there. You got to hear. If not, we were just going to put you on, but you are on. Good. Well, there you are. I got you. Okay, right after another choral selection. Let me just say a couple of words about this mentoring program.
First of all, the mundane stuff. It takes money, normally, to get things off the ground. We put money into the appropriations bill. We had it. We lost the whole every appropriation, the funding of the government. Very disappointing, and I don't know whether we're going to get that money back. It's going to be very difficult now because we've got a new agenda with some new people in charge of the Congress. More than money, far more importantly than money, it takes leadership. And that's what we have got in Alexandria and particularly with the people who are sitting here in front of you, behind me. That's the leadership of the community. And the men who are sitting here in the audience, all of you have decided to, and more the men than the women really, this is where the men are going to step up, have decided to make a difference that needs to be accomplished within our community. It's based on two principles, really. The first is a fundamental one, that every life is unique, is of unlimited value, is precious. No one born into this world is like anyone else. And everyone born into this world has enormous potential contained within them. A force to really achieve anything they want if they set their mind to it and have the kind of guidance that they were meant to have. And have the support and the nurturing, the education, the confidence that comes from knowing that you are loved unequivocally, without limit. So, the first point is that we need to enable every new life in this community to be able to strive toward their potential and hopefully reach it. The second principle is that all life around us is a duality, is balanced, if you will. It's interesting the way it is, you know. Two arms, two legs, two ears, two eyes. There's a reason for that. All the beauty that we see around us is symmetrical. It's balanced. Every child, too, was meant to have a balanced experience when they come into this life of having both a mother and a father in their life. That's the way it's meant to work. That's the way that we achieve the potential of that precious life. They can play different roles. Oftentimes, the man is the provider, the protector. The woman is the caregiver, the nurturer. It can be reversed. It doesn't have to be those particular roles. But normally you need to reach your potential, both the father and the mother, not in the obvious way where it's necessary to create life, but to raise life, to enable that precious life to be everything that they were meant to be. We don't want to get too religious. That's the job of our healers and our leaders within the faith community, but you know, we can't help but believe this was God's intent, that every child have that mother and father with them as they become the person that God intended them to be. So that's what this is all about. Because we're doing it because we know in Alexandria as well as in other communities, but we care about Alexandria first, and this high school at T.C. Williams, with these communities of faith, with these leaders of the school board and the council and all, leaders within the community. We know we've got a problem in Alexandria. There are too many lives that are being born with too many obstacles in front of them. And they're not becoming the people they were meant to be. And in many ways, when they don't achieve their objectives, they kind of start a cycle. And they become the parents that they had. And in some ways, that cycle isn't bringing out their potential. And some of those cycles need to be broken and changed. Every child that we are responsible, whose birth we're responsible for, I speak as a man, my sons and daughters, that's me. Those are my genes, my blood. I know they need me. They're not going to become the person they need to be without me in their life. And although I'm going to die someday, I'm going to kind of live on through my children. And I want my children to treat their children like I wanted to be treated, like from my father and my mother. And so we're going to set up a program. We're going to create a community-wide effort that's going to show the rest of the country, the communities all over the country that are experiencing similar problems, this is the way we do it. This is the way we enable each one of those precious lives to live the life they were intended to live. We're going to step up. We're going to do what we know is right. We're going to make the sacrifice. We're going to be there when our child needs us. And some of you, some of us, didn't have our parents always there when we needed them. And we hurt. We may not have cried, but we cried inside. We're not going to let it happen to our children. So let me now yield a microphone to other folks who are going to make this work, people who represent this community, people who love all the members of this community, people who know what can be achieved when we put our heart and mind behind it. With that, let me turn it over to the superintendent of the Alexandria School System, Ward Sherman.
Thank you, Congressman Moran. Those were terrific words, inspiring. And I hope for the young men here, a lesson of life. And in fact, just to pick up on the Congressman's words for a moment, there may never be a moment like this again in your life. If you look around this room, treasure this moment and remember it always, that a member of the U.S. Congress reaches out to you directly and said, I want to lift you up. I want to be part of your lives and to assure that you contribute back to society just as he has and just as the people in this room have. And when you look around, realize what's happening. It's not just the U.S. Congressman reaching out. A member of the Virginia Board of Education, of our City Council, three members of the Board of Education, your principal, members of the faith community, a school division, and the school itself say, we believe in you. What a remarkable moment. So as we imagine what you might be in life, and as we come together as a community, unlike anything else that's being seen in this country right now, understand that we believe in you. And I have hope, and I have belief, and I have dreams, and I will work my heart out for you as we step forward this day for the rest of your lives to assure a successful lifetime that you may have. But I ask one thing of return from you. Just as we step out, just as I shook your hands this morning, I'd ask you to return that reach, that grasp, that step, and commit that you too will become something remarkable, that you'll fulfill your potential in spite of obstacles, that you'll recognize the beauty and joy that's in this room, and most importantly, the belief in you as individuals. So I am delighted to welcome all of you here today. Most importantly, I want to thank John Rosenthal and our mentors. For you to step forward and become part of their lives is truly wonderful and remarkable. And we are so appreciative as a community. So thank you all. Thank you, choir, for being patient and standing down through all of this. And it is my pleasure to introduce our principal of this remarkable high school, who has led the transformation, who is not feeling well today. So I don't suggest anybody who speaks after her shout instead of touching the microphone. Mrs. Maxson.
Good morning, everyone. The only reason why I got out of bed this morning was because of you all. I have dedicated my entire life to young people, so I can understand why our mentors want to work with you all. There isn't anything better in this world than touching a young person's life. I look at our incredible choir, and I am just amazed by you guys. They don't know how to do anything that doesn't have five parts to it. We had a holiday music, a holiday like assembly, and I said, can you guys like do Deck the Halls or Jingle Bells? They went, yeah, we'll do a Christmas Carol. It was a huge five-part thing. They are absolutely incredible. Thank you for making me so proud of you. Excuse me. You guys, the ones who have been chosen to be mentors, mentees, let me talk with you all first. One of the things that I do when I talk with students, when I'm mentoring students in my circle, is I always say to them, don't think about who you are right now. Think about who you want to be. And I ask them to look at their lives 20 years from now. In very concrete terms, I ask questions like, what kind of job do you want in 20 years? What kind of salary do you want to make? Do you want to be married? What kind of lifestyle do you want? What car do you want to drive? I ask them a series of questions, and I say, think about your life in 20 years. And you know, nobody ever says to me, I want to have a low-paying job. I want to drive a dumpy old car. I don't want to be married. People always tell me their dreams. But what I need to say to you guys today is that these dreams begin today. That in school, you are building the foundation for your lives. And what you guys are so fortunate to have are a group of men who have made it. A group of men who are responsible, productive, contributing members of our society. And they are dedicating time to help you all be the same. What a tremendous gift that is. And I hope that you will appreciate the amount of time they spent working with you. And as Dr. Sherman pointed out, when you get to be young men and you are successful in your careers and you're giving back to society, that you take the motto of each one teach one and that you carry on what's been given to you. I am so pleased and proud of Mr. Thorpe for taking this ball and running with it, and for all of our mentors. Thank you so much for working with our young people. There's nothing more rewarding than touching a child's life, although these guys are young men right now. So I congratulate you. I cannot wait to see the results of this project. Thank you all very much.
How blessed am I first? Thank you, Ms. Maxson. Ms. Max is definitely awesome, and she doesn't just actually talk the talk, she walks the walk. Very supportive, very consistent, and that's one thing that you want to see in a leader, consistency. Not changing each day, they're the same person they walk in, and that's also a good quality of a teacher. That creates safety, and it creates an opportunity for kids and adults wanting to take risks. We're going to move right on. Our next presenter is going to be the president and CEO of the Northern Virginia Urban League, Ms. Laverne Chapman Jackson. Please welcome.
I think we're going to hear from the choir once more, aren't we?
This will be after.
Oh, after?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I do what I'm told, Jim. Good morning. I want to thank our superintendent for thinking out of the box and really being someone who listens to the community and what the needs are. And I want to thank the congressman. You all know this happened because there was a news article that said something very negative about this school. It said that young black men were not achieving. Well, everybody here is going to prove them wrong. Don't you like when someone tells you you can't do something or you're not something? Then you get empowered. And that's why the Urban League is involved. We're an empowerment movement. We're about helping people to help themselves. We're going to have a very defined role here. These men are going to teach you to be the kind of men that they are. They're going to teach you to fulfill your dreams. I see a graphic artist out here. I see a music producer out here. I see an entrepreneur out here. I see a scientist out here. I see all kinds of positive young men, and they're going to help you do that. The Urban League, our role is going to be threefold. The first thing we're going to do is provide corporate access. We have a board of directors. We have relationship with corporations in this town, Northrop Grumman, Lockheed Martin, Xerox, Comcast. We're going to make sure that if you want internships there, you want summer jobs there, you want to talk to those folks, you want to get into their fellowship programs, that's going to be our job. We're going to be the organization that they come to and say, here are the 10 groups that we need to get inside. These are the boardrooms that we want to get inside. These are some other internships that we want to happen. That will be the Urban League's role. Our second role, we can talk about all the volunteerism that we want, but dollars have to be found for infrastructure, for consistency. So the grant writing, the grant research, staying on top of Congressman Moran. See, they've got to separate church and state. We don't. So we can beat them up. We can say, well, if you can't get it through appropriations, where else can we find funding? So that will be a role that we will play. And last but not least will be community support, community outreach. We're part of a coalition of 32 organizations in Northern Virginia, fraternities, sororities, other nonprofits. So we will get the word out, we will bring volunteers to you, we will make sure that the community wrap their arms around and embrace what's gonna happen here at T.C. Williams. And I just got chills today, because when I first walked in, the first thing I saw was two rows of handsome, suave, debonair, intelligent, dynamic, wonderful young men. Give yourselves a hand. Thank you for allowing me to be a part of this wonderful, wonderful movement. I look forward to working with you.
Let's give Ms. Chapman another hand. Thank you so much, Ms. Chapman. We're going to actually go move on to Albert Street Baptist Church and hear from Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley. Let's please welcome him.
Very briefly, let me just say I'm excited. I am not only to be here on this day, but to represent a church that is part of this program. I want to give you a brief history of how this began. When I first moved here to Alexandria, being new to the area, you need someone to kind of guide me through the political faces, the figures, and the potholes. Be careful as a leader that you don't make mistakes. That person in my life has always been the Reverend Dr. Lee Earle. Here in the South Central area, I came and was grateful to have someone who had befriended my father. My father was almost a mentor to him, and he's now become a mentor to me. called me one day, Blanche, and said, come on, we're going to meet Congressman Moran. It really wasn't a request. He didn't go through the proper channels of going to my executive assistant and getting scheduled. He just called me on my cell phone and told me to come on, go with him. That was not an option to say no, so we came and went to meet with the congressman. And I was amazed at the compassion and sensitivity that he had for this community. Having been involved in churches for a while, I've run upon a lot of politicians and elected officials who don't really have the heart of the community within their heart. And I sat there with Congressman Moran and was amazed at the vision he was putting forward. And Congressman, allow me just to say, I'm putting it plainly, to see this elderly white gentleman who wanted to do something in the lives of young black men was phenomenal to me. So I sat there and listened as he wanted to present and create a mentoring program based upon an article that he had seen and wanted to help young black men in this school. I sat there and my heart began to race because I knew that this was something that could be successful. Number one, because I know in my life, anything I've achieved has always been by having positive men around me who pointed me in the right direction. I was raised with a father who would always say, in order to be a man, you gotta see a man. And his presence in my life, along with many others, helped really steer me and point me in the right direction. And even to this day, I find myself leaning upon mentors like Dr. Earl and others who helped point me in the right direction. So I knew that there would be a powerful influence of mentoring. But then secondly, I knew it would be successful because in my mind, a church at its best is not a place where people come and just worship, but a place where we come and are inspired to go back out and make a change and make a difference. I've often said that the sign of a great pastor is not how many plaques he or she gets on their wall, but how many plaques their members get on their walls. And I knew that if we presented this in the right way, that there would be those whose hearts would be stirred to say, Pastor, this is something we ought to be able to do. We put the call out at Alpha Street, and I'm so grateful that we had 50 plus men who heeded the call and said, Pastor, this is what we want to be involved in. They don't want to sing in the choir. They don't want to be ushers. They don't want to teach Sunday school. They want to be involved in the lives of young men in the community. And that was a phenomenal response that we had. In order to make this thing happen, there have been some partnerships formed that really, by all intents and purposes, are strange and very unique. First of all, it is rare, and this may surprise you, to find two churches that will partner together for a greater cause. Oftentimes, we are seen as competitors, especially when our churches are two, three blocks away from one another. Both are growing, and folk are trying to compare which one is better. When in actuality, we don't believe that any church is better. We believe that churches are different and unique and cater to different individuals. And so this partnership between Alfred Street and Shiloh is rare in the world to find two historic churches that are pillars in this community, putting down the walls of congregational commitment and saying that there's something greater than our local church. Then for us to partner with the Urban League, that is not as unique and rare. That is something that's happened throughout the Urban League's history, throughout our church's history. But realizing that the Urban League has a structure and a precedence and connections that help get things done in a greater way than the local church can. Realizing we don't have to recreate the wheel, but we can go to those who've got the wheels and make it happen. We partner with the Urban League. Then for there to be a partnership with the public school system. Traditionally, church and state are so separated, you're not allowed to talk about God, you don't lift up the Lord's Prayer, and in some instances, that would keep a church out of the public school system. That many would think that our only objective is to make people Christians or to make them disciples of Christ. And because of that, partnerships have not been formed. But for Dr. Sherman, for Principal Maxey, for all those others involved in the school committee to say that this is a good idea and that we can navigate these waters of church and state in a productive way to form a partnership that will change lives, indeed is a unique partnership. I'm going to close by telling you a little story of a boy who was out on the beach one day, and the low tide had come in, and when the tide went back out, Dr. Earl, there were all these baby sea turtles lined up the seashore. Must have been thousands of them, and they were struggling for life, little baby sea turtles. A young man saw them and went out on the seashore and began picking up one at a time and throwing them back in the water, trying to save them. An elderly gentleman, a little bit pessimistic, walked by, saw this little boy taking one sea turtle at a time, throwing them in the water with a vast multitude of sea turtles that were dying. And he said to him, "Son, you'll never make a difference. All these sea turtles are going to die, and you're just doing them one at a time." The little boy looked at the elderly gentleman, reached out, picked up another sea turtle, and threw him back in. He said, "I may not save all of them, but I made a difference in that one." That's what this program is about for us, realizing that there is a great epidemic of male presence within our young men, but we know that if we can make a difference in these 30 that are committed to this program, then we've done a great work. And so it's a great joy that I partner along with this, and call the men of Alpha Street to partner with the men of Shiloh and the other community leaders, and we're excited about what the future holds and what's going to happen in the lives of these young men. And thank you for the blessed privilege and opportunity to be part of this.
Could we please give Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley another hand? Thank you. We're going to move to the front of my room, the Shiloh Baptist Church, and have Reverend Dr. Lee Earls to join us. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
To our honorees, the young men that you are the focus of what we're doing this morning, and to all of those that are gathered, Dr. Wesley, I appreciate my young friend calling me a mentor. His father certainly mentored me, and my uncle mentored his father, and my grandfather mentored my uncle. And it all goes back to an old guy named Cornelius Diggs, who was the brother of Charles Diggs, who moved to Detroit and started the House of Diggs, and Congressman Diggs. Started along with Adam Clayton Powell, the Congressional Black Caucus. And so I say that to say that mentoring one generation to another has been such a vital part of all that we do. Let me also say that sandwiched between Shiloh Baptist Church and Alpha Street Baptist Church is the Urban League, and this very lovely lady. So on that morning when we assembled in the congressman's office, you know, integrity is vital, because no matter what we do, without integrity and proper management of resources, it ends up being so counterproductive. And so on that morning, once we all came together and decided that this is what we would do, the congressman started throwing around those large figures, and Dr. Wesley and I looked and said, "Now the quickest way for a preacher to get in trouble is money." And so we said, "How are we going to do this?" And we said, "Laverne Chapman has to handle the money." And so I'm just very grateful, very thankful for this commitment, for this opportunity, for this coming together. What I know will be just a great outcome, a great success, and for the partnership, not only between the two churches, but Brother Rosenthal, Brother Bill, others, that I know what to do and know how to do it. And for those men that have made this commitment, and let me say this, and I take my seat. Years ago, living on the south side of a factory town just outside of Detroit, it was a segregated community, and at our high school, they hired the first African-American male teacher. His name was Colin McGlown. Colin McGlown, I was fortunate enough that they bought a house across the street from us. One day he came out of the front door and he had a football in his hand. And he taught me two things. He taught me how to throw a football correctly, and he taught me what a butt hook was, the pass pattern. After I finished high school, I was able to use his relationship, what he had taught me that day on the sidewalk, went onto the football field, and it helped me to get to college and helped me to get through college. He mentored me. Later, he went into real estate. He took me into the real estate business. And so all along, Mr. McGlown, from that day that he moved across the street, and I saw for the first time in my life, I saw a black man get up, put a tie on, not go into a factory, but put a tie on and go to work. And he went to work after we got up, not in the wee hours of the morning, but we saw him go to work. And he got off. He got off work early enough to come out on the sidewalk and show us how to throw footballs and how to play. And then he taught us that no matter what we did, that at the end of the day, we had to also go in the backyard and get our homework done. And because of that mentoring, through the generations there on the south side of Chicago, right on up until right there in that little factory town, until this very day, the key to being a success and staying out of the wrong places is that somebody takes the time. And these men are committed. This is a great day and a great opportunity. And this is a great city, and we have great leaders that will make this happen. Please, whatever you do, take advantage of it. It can be the most important step that you take in your life. Thank you.
Give Dr. Irwin another hand for being with us today. We really appreciate that. We're going to move right along and actually bring up one of our mentors, Mr. John Roosevelt.
Actually, you got to get three to one. All right, now we're going to try to do this real quickly. Thank you, guys. This is working on this program has been one of the most inspirational and important things that for me this year. We help you guys out. And it started out with a lot of late night phone calls. We would caucus at 9:30 on Monday evenings to plan this program. Then we met and with the school representatives and the students, and we mapped it out. Pastor Wesley, my pastor, spoke about strange partnerships. Well, I want to tell you about a partnership here in one quick second. The partnership that we put together to work on this program. And one of my partners, my closest partner, who is truly, I call him my son behind his back, T'Shaka Cunningham. The strange partnership, he is much smarter than me. This guy's a scientist. He can say stuff that I can't even look up in the dictionary. Can't even Google. He's a Kappa man. I'm a Q. That's all right. But Pastor West is a Kappa as well. But to show you the solidarity that we have, this will mean something to you young men later on in life. Q colors are purple and gold. I'm wearing a purple necktie. Somebody else may be wearing a gold necktie. That shows the solidarity here. Just the solidarity, I'm just saying. Anyway, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Cunningham and Mr. Porter, Dr. Porter, to give you guys a few more expressions of our appreciation.
Thanks, John. This is just a great day. I'm T'Shaka Cunningham, and as John mentioned, I'm a scientist. I'm a member of Alpha Street Baptist Church, and a recent addition to the Alexandria community. And I'm just so happy to be here and be a part of this program that we're putting together. And most importantly, I'm happy for you guys, you young guys. You guys are going to get so much out of this. I'm not that much older than you. No. Not yet. I'm getting up there, getting a few gray hairs. But I can remember being in your position. And I came from a single-parent home. My dad wasn't there either. So I know what that's all about. And we can go through all of that. We're going to go through the types of things you'll need to do to get through that and overcome that and let that be something that makes you better, because it can be. And I'm here to testify to that. But I just wanted to say that this is a really unique partnership, as our pastor said. And it was brought together by the leaders of our community. And that is one of the most special things I've ever seen. And as Congressman Moran said, I think the eyes of the world are going to be watching us. And they're going to be watching what we do here. And it's going to be very special. And it's going to be a closing of ranks of this community around you guys. We want you all to fulfill your dreams, to achieve everything you want to achieve in life, and we're here to help you. So I'm going to turn it over to Bill and Shiloh, who's been our close partner at this, and let him have the last word for us.
I'm a lot older than you guys. As a matter of fact, I have a grandson that's older than you guys. One of the things that Pastor Earl Morris preaches, at least that's what I hear, is practical theology. So this mentoring program is a perfect fit for practical theology. I was meeting with the guys last night, and I said, the students don't want to know what you know. They want to observe what you do. And that's what we're here for. Thank you.
I'd like to also acknowledge our fourth partner, Tyree Anderson, who couldn't be with us today. He's been very helpful. And I'd also like to acknowledge the mentors who gave up what looked like half their work to come out here with us this morning. So with the mentors, please stand. Let's give them a big hand.
Give Mr. Rosenthal, Tashaka Cunningham, and Dr. Porter a hand. We want to thank you for being here this morning. We're going to move right to the next portion of our program. The exciting piece is that actually what these students are going to be taking part in, we actually had a session in November where the students had a chance to meet with our mentors and really talk about what they want. We really didn't want a mentoring program that was touchy-feely, kind of sit down and explain my experience to you. We wanted something that was very concrete, something that these students could walk away with, that they would have a roadmap for whatever it is they wanted to do throughout life. But with that roadmap, we wanted to give them some specific strategies to actually help move through that. I'm actually going to have several of our mentees, if they'll just kind of go to, and this is in your packet, if you'll go through that with them and take you through that really quick. If you'll go to the third page, and we're going to start with that very first section, and I'm going to actually have one of our students, if you'll just kind of give us an introduction of what that is, Mr. Bill Bonanza.
Okay, workshop type, session one. Get to know slash create a complete contract. Overview. The students will create a contract for participation.
Thank you. Our next section is actually emotional intelligence. Goals and values. The students will have share strategies and develop the ability to always be in control of their emotions. And I actually talked to Mr. Coakley this morning. Mr. Coakley, yes, you want to share, would you share with me this morning?
Well, briefly, my brother Harry Stewart and I were talking about this, and this topic actually comes from the title of the book by Mr. Goldman, and he and I, Brother Stewart and I, will be hitting on some topics in that book, and we think it's time to work into the session.
Thank you. One of the pieces that we wanted to cover, when you look at emotional intelligence, and I've been in education for about 17 years, taught in 18 schools and I've been in 8 school divisions. It wasn't my plan, but this has some great opportunities. I actually grew up with my grandparents, which gave me a lot of foundation. They kept me grounded. I also have this year, I have a lot of ministers in my family. We have 4 churches. So that kept me grounded. Mom was an executive in sales. My dad was a race car driver. But my dad was also a straight A student. So he was my fun person, but he also made sure I had all my A's. And mom was very intense, made sure that I was polished constantly. And then I had to go back to my grandparents so I could relax a little bit. So I'm very, very, very grateful for my upbringing. In my household, you were going to be successful. You had to do it 15 times. I'll tell you a story about my mom. I wrote a report, I'll never forget it, in third grade on Stevie Wonder. Growing up, I wasn't allowed to use a pencil because I wasn't allowed to erase. I had to write in pen. So if I made a mistake, I had to rewrite the whole report. I rewrote Stevie Wonder probably 8 times. I can tell you everything about him, from where he was born, his mom named Dagny. But again, it's about having people in your life that are consistent, that will push you, that does not give you an opportunity to make sure that you are unsuccessful. They make sure that you are successful. When we look at the piece of emotional intelligence, we want to make sure that our students are getting strategies that are life strategies. Giving them the ability to control their emotions regardless of what experience that they're in. There's a lot of variables in life that they're going to go through. So we can't necessarily control their variables, but we can give them strategies to deal with what they may experience. When we look at our next section, we're going to have this introduced by Mr. Hashim Taylor.
Okay. Session 3, I have a bright future, I am mentally fit. Overview, students will be sharing strategies to help them become mentally fit.
Thank you. And again, these sessions actually came from your students and the mentors. The exciting part is each session, one of our mentors actually has professional training those areas, so that piece is very exciting. This section about being mentally fit, you have a lot of different things that go on in the world. Students and even adults experience different people in their life. It's extremely important to make sure that you guard your thoughts or guard what actually goes into your psyche. So we want to talk and have some of those kinds of discussions. Again, this is not a touchy-feely mentoring program. We're trying to make sure that these boys lead with a roadmap to make sure that they're successful with whatever they may experience. Our next section is going to actually be introduced by Mr. DeAndre Dreher.
Session 4, Peace Equals Life, Overview. Students will be given examples of the importance of having a balanced life.
On this section where we talk about peace equals life, our students are going to be, when they experience a lot of things out on a daily basis as it is in school, outside of school, and as they definitely begin to go to college, it's extremely important that they have an ability to identify peace, to identify a time in their life to where they can kind of pull things back together. It could be 100 people around them, but they need to be able to identify how to have peace regardless of what's going on in their life. That's really important. I can tell you one thing that I've learned about peace is worth more than money. Any amount of money that you have, if you don't have peace in your life, there's no reason to have that much money. So we want to make sure that they have life skills, again, that's going to help them be consistently successful regardless of what adversity. Adversity will probably be their friend. I can tell you as an African-American male at 40, adversity will probably be their friend, but we want to give them success as their foundation through this program. And that's what we want to make sure that happens. Our next session is actually, I respect myself and my friends, law of environment. This actually came up from one of our counselors, which I thought was really interesting. Law of environment, talking about making sure that regardless of where they are, that they don't become part of that entity, but that they know how to function within that entity. And still make sure that they're successful in that experience. Our next section is going to be introduced by Mr. Tyree Roberson.
Session 6, intelligence. There's a difference in being smart and using your intelligence to become successful.
That session actually came up from one of our students also. We want to actually teach them how to make sure that they flow through all those frames appropriately. We want to just give you a quick overview today. There is a second page there that I'll have you go through after you leave. But again, we're very excited to actually have the students here, have our mentors. We had about 4 planning sessions with the guys here in the building. So we want to just say thank you for that. I also want to make sure that I thank our central office staff that I did not acknowledge at the beginning, Dr. John Brown in the back, Ms. Gorsuch, our school board member, Ms. Manassas, school board member, Ms. Taylor, our academic principal for English, Ms. Hall, our academic principal for math and science, Ms. Eisenhower, our principal for pathways, Ms. Barnett, our graduation coach, one of my right hands, Ms. Nielsen, Ms. Alexander, our new person, am I missing anyone? Mr. Lawrence, Dr. Temple, Ms. Morrison, thank you. And I have to also say again, we have a very, very, very supportive school division. Whenever we have things that happen with our students, regardless of whether it's a concert or whether it's a debate, they're here. So we're very, very excited about that. I want to say thank you to Dr. Sherman again for his support, Ms. Maxey, very supportive. And again, we're looking forward to this. If there's any support that you would like to offer and you're not currently a mentor, just please give us a call and I'll give that information to our Arthur Street and Shiloh team and we'll make sure that happens. Again, thank you for coming and have a good day.